The Omicron subvariant fueling China's COVID wave reaches the Philippines.
Malacanang claims President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s recent trips abroad yielded over $23 billion in investment pledges.
A power rate hike feared next year as the Malampaya gas field undergoes a two-week maintenance in February.
And a massive winter storm in the U.S. disrupts the holiday plans of millions.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Cruz.
And I'm Denise Insai.
You're watching Top Stories. A new Omicron subvariant has reached the Philippines. The health department has confirmed it has detected four cases of the Omicron subvariant BF.7. This is a strain driving the current surge in COVID cases in China. Researchers have warned the BF.7 could be more transmissible than the BA.5. The health department reiterated the importance of face masks and vaccination. An infectious diseases expert also noted the need for local officials to monitor the COVID wave in China. But Dr. Rondin Solante also points out the surge should be studied first before border restrictions are imposed. Solante also believes the Philippines is in a more stable situation now due to a good vaccination rate.
I think hindi na tayo abot doon sa mga 25 or 30,000 na nangyari last January of this year because of the Omicron variant. If there will be uptick of cases, I think this will not be more than 3,000 or 5,000. No? And this is something more or less manageable.
A Philippine pharmaceutical group backs the speedy procurement of bivalent COVID-19 vaccines. But the group says the government must do better to prevent vaccine wastage. Earlier this month, the DOH revealed up to 44 million COVID shots have gone to waste.
We need to do better planning in terms of how much vaccines to procure. We need to balance the supply to the demand. That way, we hopefully eliminate any potential losses. The other thing that we need to consider is also making sure that, you know, we're up to date in terms of the systems that we utilize on the supply chain. I think that was one of the areas that we saw we could have improved in the rollout of the national vaccination program last year.
In China, the government has taken over the production of medical supplies across the country. That's as millions struggle to get their hands on basic drugs and test kits amid an unprecedented surge in COVID cases. At least 11 test kit manufacturers are now operating under government orders. Their products will be requisitioned by local government units. Pharmacies in major cities have been stripped bare following the government's sudden decision to lift its draconian anti-COVID measures after nearly 3 years. Hospitals are filling up and authorities are now urging those with mild symptoms to stay at home and take their treatment into their own hands.
U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken urges China to share information on its new COVID outbreak. His remarks on Thursday, echoing the World Health Organization's call for Chinese officials to provide details on its COVID situation. Blinken stressed information sharing on the health crisis is vital for the whole world. He says, although Beijing has not sought help from Washington to deal with its new COVID wave, the U.S. is ready to provide assistance.
Turning now to the holiday travel rush here in the Philippines, passengers at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport brave long lines to get home for Christmas. Vivian Gulia found this report.
It's slow going for traffic along Ninoy Aquino International Airport Terminal 3's driveway as several vehicles drop off passengers leaving for other parts of the country or abroad to spend the holidays. At the entrances, we are seeing relatively shorter lines after the Manila International Airport Authority removed the initial screening there. Passengers now need to just present their ticket, ID, and get their bags screened through the X-ray machine to enter NAIA terminals. But inside NAIA 3, the lines of passengers checking in are visibly longer, consistent with the expectation of MIA on the last weekday before Christmas. In anticipation of the volume of passengers, the Philippine Airlines opened check-in counters for domestic flights 24/7 and those for international flights 6 hours ahead of departure. AirAsia, meanwhile, said it added personnel to speed up the check-in process. Due to the huge volume of passengers at NAIA, some passengers at Terminal 4 had to deal with a shortage in push carts. At Terminal 1, the luggage of some passengers who arrived yesterday from Canada on board a Philippine Airlines flight was delayed. Some of them returned to the terminal today to check on their luggage, only to be dismayed because many are not yet available. PAL explained some baggage had to be offloaded from the flight to maintain aircraft weight at a certain threshold for the safety of the flight amid heavy snow and strong winds in Vancouver. But it assured affected passengers that their luggage will be carried on the next available flights. MIA has so far recorded over 2.5 million passengers from December 1 to 22. More than half of this figure, or 1.5 million, are domestic.
Provincial buses, meanwhile, are now allowed to use Metro Manila's main highway amid the travel rush. Zian Ambrosio has the story.
Influx passengers were seen at the Baliwag Transit in Quezon City this morning. The transit company increased their capacity by adding 15 more buses to accommodate the additional passenger load who are leaving for their provinces. According to one of the managers of Baliwag Transit, Mr. Martin San Gabriel, their passengers doubled from 3,000 passengers per day to 6,000 passengers per day. They lauded the MNBA for changing its initial policy towards EDSA, allowing the ease of travel for passengers. Before, buses were not allowed in EDSA and were asked to reroute in other roads such as Mindanao Avenue and Calayan Avenue, where they are stuck in traffic. Meantime, in the Ayala bus port in Quezon City, the passengers also increased by more than 500 per day, from an average of 1,200 all the way to an average of 2,000 passengers. For the bus terminal manager, Mon Legaspi, the MMD advisory to use EDSA for provincial buses is good news, although it is not impactful because they only provide short bus trips to Pampanga, Laguna, and Batangas. Other bus managers also lauded the MMDA as they are going to benefit from the advisory to use EDSA beginning tomorrow until January 2. Even passengers thank the MMDA for this.
The Philippine government doubling down on its effort to ensure smooth sailing or a smooth sailing transport system this holiday season. Transportation Undersecretary Timothy John Bataan says they have implemented a no-leave policy for key personnel, including maritime officers and the Philippine Coast Guard, to assist the riding public this Christmas. Meanwhile, the DOTR says it's now expediting the release of fuel subsidies to public transport drivers.
We are mobilizing and coordinating with the DILG and the concerned local governments to expedite. Our local governments, they're on the ground. Kita nila yung mga toda nila, and they have better visibility and relationships with them. So by this initiative of, again, Senator Alan Peter Cayetano together with the Secretary Jimmy Bautista, we are pushing to increase the percentage of distribution within this year and continuing into the following year.
Shopping malls in Metro Manila can now return to their normal operating hours. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority says malls may open as early as 9 in the morning to give the public more time to do some last-minute Christmas shopping. Authorities earlier told malls to operate from 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. during the holiday season to avoid traffic buildup.
Other news, the overseas blitz of Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. yields billions of dollars in investment pledges. The value, $23.6 billion, covering his trips in Indonesia, Singapore, Cambodia, Thailand, and the U.S. The nearly 10 billion pesos worth of investment pledges during his recent visit to Belgium was not yet included in the Trade Department's accomplishment report. Marcos held meetings with business communities at the sidelines of those trips to woo foreign investors. For next year, Marcos will fly to China for a state visit. He will also attend the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland.
The Development Bank of the Philippines has a new chief. Marcos named former Supreme Court Associate Justice Dante Osorio Tinga as chairman of the state-owned bank. Tinga served as Associate Justice from 2003 to 2009 during the Arroyo administration. His appointment comes amid concerns about the DBP becoming a potential source of seed funding for the proposed Maharlika Investment Fund.
An early Christmas gift. That's how Filipino activist Reyna May Nacino describes her temporary freedom after posting bail Thursday. Nacino's case drew nationwide condemnation in 2020 after she was separated from her newborn child, whom she had given birth to while in prison. The infant died 3 months later.
Wala naman pong ina na dapat mapalayo sa anak. Dapat hindi po talaga maulit yun. Dahil hindi lang po ako yung nakakaranas nun. Marami pa pong kababaihan na nakakaranas po nun na pinaglalayo sa inaaresto, illegal na inaaresto, tapos nilalayo sa anak.
Lalo po kami kay Baby River.
Nacino and her fellow activists, Alma Moran and Ram Bautista, were arrested in a raid in Manila back in 2019 for alleged illegal possession of firearms. Speaking to reporters Friday, the three reiterated their call to free other political prisoners.
Siyempre, kailangan palayain po yung political prisoner katulad po namin. Hindi lang dapat kami yung palayain ngayong Pasko rin. Mas masaya siguro kung mas marami po yung palayain ng mga political prisoners. Dahil ayun po yung matagal na nating panawagan.
Suspended Prisons Chief Gerald Bantag opened to an investigation by the Commission on Audit into corruption allegations against him. The acting head of the Bureau of Corrections is set to file a plunder case against Bantag for supposedly pocketing up to 350 million pesos in public funds meant for the construction and repair of jail facilities. His lawyer says they will wait for whatever cases will be filed against Bantag, adding they will answer them in the proper forum. Bantag also addressing accusations. He stabbed two inmates at the National Penitentiary earlier this year. He challenged his accusers to prove their claims.
Six individuals indicted over their alleged involvement in the kidnapping of six cockfighting enthusiasts in Tanay, Rizal. A panel of prosecutors from the Justice Department said the suspects conspired in kidnapping the victims. But the respondents are denying the accusations. They claim the witnesses have no personal knowledge of the crime, and some of them were not even present during the alleged kidnapping. The cockfighting enthusiasts have been missing since January 13. The Philippine National Police admits they are having difficulty locating dozens of missing cockfight enthusiasts amid the lack of witnesses.
Investigation na Sir Peter na ito talagang mga kaso na ito ay magkakadugtong dahil nga it appears na iisang grupo po ang nasa likod na po itong pagkakawala nitong mga 34 missing persons.
Elderly inmates from a correctional facility for women appeal for their release, having spent decades inside jail. Let's hear their stories from Sherry Ann Torres.
Meet 89-year-old Celine of Pangasinan. She's one of the oldest person deprived of liberty in the correctional institution for women in Mandaluyong City. Celine says she was convicted for selling illegal drugs but could no longer remember how long she has been locked up. And all this time, she says, she was never visited by any of her six children. Celing is one of the 289 PDLs that the Bureau of Corrections wants to be released this Christmas. As Christmas Day nears, Celing prays hard she will be able to finally go home.
Kaya ko lang bisis isang araw yan, palagi na pinapanalan ko yung makalaya na ako para makapiling ko na ang mga mahal sa buhay. Bakulungisan sa mundong ito. Kasi alam ko na matanda na ako.
Another inmate, 76-year-old Merly, says she's willing to beg in front of President Marcos Jr. and appeal for her freedom. Merly was convicted for selling cannabis.
Palayain mo naman ako para makita ko man lang yung aking maapo na hindi ko kilala at yung mga anak ko. Tumatanda din sila. Oh, yun lang ang aking masabi sa presidente. Kung maaari, maawa po sa akin.
Dali, another inmate, says acceptance is the key to surviving life behind bars. The 78-year-old former teacher landed in jail for illegal recruitment. While she finds happiness teaching her fellow inmates for more than two decades now, Dali also longs to be free so she can be with her family. Inmates hope the government will assign additional lawyers to fast-track their cases and expedite the processing of old and sick PDLs.
Mama ko kasi namatay. Hindi ko na nakita. Namatay siya last year. Yun ang pinaka-fallback ko pag naalala ko yung family ko. Yung mga anak ko, malalaki na sila ngayon. Nung iniwan ko, baby, din pupunta sila, hindi ko na namumukaan, kundi pa ako tatapikin, ma.
There are also 15 bedridden PDLs in the CIW that the Bucor is working to release soon. The CIW has more than 3,323 PDLs, which is more than twice its capacity of 1,235.
Siguro yung mga pending case na matatagal naman na o naka-archive, baka hindi na rin naman siguro kailangan. Lalo na yung mga ganyang may sakit. Sana ma'am mabigyan sa lalong madaling panahon ng pansin.
The names of these elderly and sick PDLs are already included in the list of pardon and parole or executive clemency applicants waiting for the president's signature. Sharian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Let's now get an outlook on the weather in the Philippines this Christmas weekend. We have on the line PAGASA forecaster Aldzar Aurelio. Aldzar?
Hello and good afternoon to all of you. Right now, the northeast monsoon has maintained its strength and intensified further. So right now, northeast monsoon is still affecting Luzon, but will also affect Visayas today or tomorrow. The low pressure area spotted east of Mindanao has weakened, but we expect scattered rain showers and thunderstorm over the whole country. Shear line right now affecting Bicol region and eastern Visayas. So the weather forecast for tomorrow, because of northeast monsoon, we expect scattered rains and thunderstorm over Cagayan Valley, Cordillera region, Aurora and Quezon. While Visayas, Bicol region, and Palawan, which they will experience scattered rain showers and thunderstorm due to shear line. While the rest of Luzon and also the whole Mindanao will have generally fair weather, but expect isolated rain showers. Cool weather will be experienced over Luzon and Visayas, especially. In the early morning due to the northeast monsoon. Right now we have gale warning. It means we expect rough to very rough seas over the seaboards of Luzon and also the seaboards of Visayas. So so the gale warning, we expect rough to very rough seas. So the residents of these areas avoid this seaboard of the stone and Visayas because of the high waves. Tomorrow, the lowest temperature over Metro Manila will be at 24 degrees Celsius. From Pagasa, I am Alzar D. Aurelio.
Thanks for the forecast, Alzar.
Over in the U.S., a massive winter storm spells a real nightmare before Christmas for thousands of passengers stranded due to bad weather. Our North America Bureau correspondent Don Tagala has this report.
It's beginning to look a lot like a bitter cold white Christmas in most of the Northeast Coast and the Midwest as weather experts forecast a bomb cyclone. Winter Storm Elliott has already brought high winds and heavy snow that disrupted flights and closed major roads and highways across the Midwest. And the worst is yet to come. The winter storm is expected to reach its peak tomorrow, Friday. In the Northeast, including New York and New Jersey, rain is expected to turn into snow, followed by bitter cold air that experts believe could result to flash freeze and icy conditions in certain areas. Winter Storm Elliott is expected to drop over a foot of snow, the heaviest targeting the Great Lakes, while high winds are expected to cause some damage from downed trees to power outages in the Midwest and the East Coast. Travelers are warned to avoid or rethink their travel plans tomorrow and over the weekend as Winter Storm Elliott is expected to impact travel. Blizzard warnings have been issued in the upper Midwest and the Great Lakes, including Buffalo, New York, Des Moines, Iowa, Grand Rapids, Michigan, and South Dakota. Winter storm warnings and winter weather advisories are in effect in the upper Midwest to the Great Lakes. Those who can't avoid travel or going out are advised to bundle up and be ready for snow, strong winds, and extreme cold that may cause frostbite on exposed skin in just a matter of minutes.
A U.S. congressional panel releases its official findings on the deadly January 6 Capitol riot. Central to the panel's report, former President Donald Trump, which it accused of engaging in a multi-part conspiracy to overturn the results of the 2020 presidential race. The House panel says Trump failed to act to stop his supporters from attacking the Capitol. It also cites his repeated false claims of voter fraud. The committee says Trump should be barred from holding office again. The report's release concludes the panel's 18-month probe into Trump, who is eyeing a comeback to the White House in 2024. The committee earlier this week recommended the filing of four criminal charges against Trump, including insurrection and fraud.
The U.S. Senate approves a sweeping annual spending package that includes a $45 billion aid for Ukraine. The measure also contains election reforms aimed at avoiding a repeat of last year's assault on the U.S. Capitol. The $1.7 trillion spending bill now needs to be rubber-stamped by the House of Representatives before the Friday midnight deadline to avoid a government shutdown.
U.S. President Joe Biden seeking to strike a unifying message in his Christmas speech this year. On Thursday, Biden urged Americans to set aside partisan politics, shun division, and embrace the spirit of the holidays.
So my hope this Christmas season is that we take a few moments of quiet reflection. Find that stillness in the heart of Christmas. It's at the heart of Christmas. And look, really look at each other. Not as Democrats or Republicans, not as members of Team Red or Team Blue, but as who we really are, fellow Americans. I hope this Christmas season marks a fresh start for our nation, because there's so much that unites us as Americans, so much more that unites us than divides us. We're truly blessed to live in this nation.
Up next, the U.S. accuses North Korea of supplying arms to a Russian mercenary group.
And power and water rates in the Philippines expected to go up next year. Find out why when we return.
Watching top story, here again are the headlines. The Omicron subvariant fueling China's COVID wave reaches the Philippines.
Malacanang claims President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s recent trips abroad yielded over $23 billion in investment pledges.
A power rate hike feared next year as the Malampaya gas field undergoes a two-week maintenance in February.
And a massive winter storm in the U.S. disrupts the holiday plans of millions.
More world news. Russia warns America's increased support for Ukraine could lead to an escalation of the conflict. It accused Kyiv and Washington of turning a deaf ear to its concerns, saying the U.S. was using Ukraine as a battleground to weaken Russia. The statements come following Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky's historic visit to the U.S., his first foreign trip since Russia's invasion. There, he received promises of more aid, including a $1.8 billion security assistance. But Russian President Vladimir Putin brushed this off and said the other side is just prolonging the conflict. Putin claims Moscow was aiming for a speedy end to the fighting. But the U.S. asserts Russia has shown no real interest in ending its war on Ukraine.
Fundamentally, right now, Russia has shown no interest in meaningful diplomacy, in meaningfully engaging to bring this war to an end.
The U.S. accuses North Korea of supplying arms to a Russian mercenary group. White House National Security Spokesman John Kirby says Pyongyang sold infantry rockets and missiles to Wagner last month. Kirby notes the move violated United Nations Security Council resolutions and will prompt new sanctions from the U.S. He adds Wagner now rivals the Russian military in power and has been spending more than $100 million each month in Ukraine. The mercenary group has faced U.S. sanctions since 2017. It is accused of numerous human rights abuses across Africa, where it has been particularly active.
Over in Afghanistan, the Taliban's Minister of Education defends a controversial university ban on women, saying it was partly because they were violating the strict dress code. According to the minister, female students were also ignoring Islamic rules about being accompanied by a male relative when traveling. He also says some science subjects were not suitable for women, such as engineering and agriculture. The ban had drawn global outrage, including from Muslim countries. G7 nations also condemning the Taliban's move, saying it may amount to crimes against humanity.
Changing one's gender made easier in Scotland. Lawmakers passed a contentious law Thursday that drops the need for a medical diagnosis of gender dysphoria to alter people's gender. Those aged 16 and 17 will also now be allowed to change their gender after efforts to keep the minimum age at 18 were rejected. The legislation had sparked protests in Edinburgh. Critics fear it could be dangerous for women and girls, but the government justified the measure.
I will do everything I can to protect women's rights for as long as I live. But I also think it's an important part of my responsibility to make life a little bit easier for stigmatized minorities in our country, to make their lives a bit better and to remove some of the trauma that they live with on a day-to-day basis.
Philippine Consul General in New York, El Mercato, gets a warm send-off as he leaves his new post in Italy. Don Tagala has more.
Just a couple of days before Philippine Consul General El Mercato leaves for his new post in Milan, Italy, New York City Mayor Eric Adams sends his congratulations to the Filipino diplomat with this citation of honor for completing his service in the Big Apple.
I applaud your achievements and your work to fortify the ties between our nations and address important issues that impact people in the five boroughs and beyond, including New York City's effort to come back stronger from the pandemic and combat the rise in anti-Asian bias fueled by COVID-19 misinformation. On behalf of the City of New York, I offer you my best wishes for for joyous holiday season and continued success as you take on your next posting in Milan. Sincerely, Eric Adams, Mayor.
In return, Cato sent a certificate of recognition to Adams through the mayor's Asian Affairs Advisory Member, Potri Rangkamanis.
And the certificate of recognition to Mayor Eric Adams reads, "The certificate of recognition is presented to Mayor Eric Adams for his outstanding leadership that opened the door for stronger collaboration between New York City and the Philippine Consulate General, as demonstrated by the historic raising of the flag of the Republic of the Philippines in Bowling Green and efforts to address concerns of members of the Filipino community, given this 21st day of December 2022, signed by Consul General Elmer G. Cato."
And are grateful for your service.
Meanwhile, New York State Assembly Member Jessica Gonzalez Rojas presented the outgoing Consul General with a citation of honor for his efforts in addressing incidents of violence and anti-Asian hate crimes involving Filipinos.
He's done a lot of work around anti-Asian hate, calling that out. He's made sure to make sure that people at the front lines, many of our Filipino health workers, were being cared for. And when Ida happened, he made sure that the Filipino-Americans, the Filipino nationals, got access to services.
Well, I was really touched by the gesture. Siyempre, galing ako Libya. Pagdating ko pa lang, yun ay sumalubong sa akin. So sabi ko, from one conflict zone to another. But yun yung importante. Sabi, the third pillar of Philippine foreign policy is assistance to nationals. It's really important to assure our people that the consulate is there for them.
Cato says, while there is a downtrend in the number of cases related to anti-Asian hate and criminality, PhilAm should remain vigilant and not let their guard down.
Napakalaki ng Filipino population natin dito. So we just need to organize, educate the rest of our kababayan so they could play an active role in local politics. And we hope to see more Filipino-Americans assume electoral office here in New York and other parts of the United States.
Stephen Raga recently became the first PhilAm to be elected to the New York State Assembly. Gonzalez Rojas says with Raga taking over her district, the PhilAm's growing political power will be key in getting issues such as violence and anti-Asian hate crimes addressed by city and state officials.
I'm so honored to have lost it to the first Filipino-American in the state assembly. So we voted him in, right? This community voted him in. What I would ask is that people support him because he will be fighting. It is very difficult to fight for your community in a body of 150 other assembly members.
This is the first time the Filipino community came together to donate, to participate, to volunteer in a primary election we won. I'm the first, but I'm definitely not the last, so we have to start building that base.
Conjen Cato believes that he is leaving for Milan on Friday with assurance that the Filipino community is in good hands with PhilAms in the city and state governments. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
The Malampaya Natural Gas Facility, which powers Luzon plants, will go on a two-week scheduled maintenance shutdown starting February 4, 2023. The Energy Department says it has contingency measures in place to ensure there will be no power outages during that time. But it admits power rates could go higher as the gas-fired Luzon plants will shift to more expensive fuel during the shutdown. Meanwhile, power distributor Meralco has started the so-called competitive selection process for 480 megawatts of electricity to fill the gap left by the Malampaya maintenance and to address the expected increase in power demand during the summer.
Aside from potentially higher power rates, consumers are also expected to deal with a hike in water rates next year. Regulators reveal they have approved a 25% environment charge for Manila Water. The environmental charge has also seen to move up for Maynilad customers.
Ito po ay ang percentage po ng water tariff. Ito po ay ginagamit ng ating concessionaires para po to protect the watershed, at ito po ang ginagamit for wastewater. So ito po ang ginagamit nila for sa sewerage lines pag-expand nito.
The prices of holiday food staples will remain stable until the end of 2022. The president of the Amalgamated Supermarkets Association says they don't expect any movement in prices since there is currently enough supply of Nochebuena and Medianoche items. He adds there are still a lot of promo deals available as manufacturers try to hit their sales targets.
Kung ito pong magki-Christmas ay walang changes, kung stable yung supply nila, ito naman pong mag-New Year, after a week, meron po bang paggalaw tayong inaasahan or still the same?
Not very likely coming from the suppliers. If ever yung sinabi kong kinulang ang supply, yun ang ano doon. Kasi around by the 15th of December, medyo ano na, production medyo nag-stop na yan, nag-hold na yan, di ba? So wala nang changes normally in prices coming from suppliers. Yeah.
A pre-Christmas plunge seen across Asia as investors worry about rising inflation in Japan. This report.
Stocks in Asia failed to get into the Christmas spirit as a hot inflation report from Japan puts a damper on investors' holiday cheer. The Nikkei Index down sharply after data showed core consumer prices in Tokyo rising. Listless trading also prevailing at the Philippine Stock Exchange ahead of the holidays. Value turnover, only a little over 3 billion pesos. The main index snapping a three-day winning streak to close at 65.41. Regina Capital says Philippine shares were sold off ahead of the long weekend. An analyst says the same listless trading is expected in the last few days of 2022.
Low volume, low volatility. So I can expect the same type of behavior next week. We only have 3 trading days next week, so I don't really expect much. So we'll just probably be consolidating between, maybe between 6.4 and 6.7 at most.
Meanwhile, the most actively traded stock today is still PLDT amid its budget overrun issue. The stock ending the day down 1.5%. But analysts say the panic has subsided.
It really helped that, management was candid enough, was open enough to, explain to the market, explain to investors what happened. And this openness and this honesty from the management is what's making the price more stable right now. If you ask me, I think this should be a good opportunity to buy the stock in the long term. But of course, in the short term, or maybe in the next 6 to 12 months, we might see some, continued consolidation and volatility in the stock.
For 2023, choppy trade is expected, especially in the first half of the year, due to concerns about global recession. A stark admission from TikTok parent company ByteDance. The Chinese tech giant reveals some of its employees improperly accessed the TikTok user data of two journalists from the Financial Times and BuzzFeed. This as they investigated potential employee leaks to the press. The ByteDance staffers looked at the IP addresses of the journalists to see if they were in the same location as the employees suspected of leaking confidential information. The admission comes after the company intensified a campaign to reassure customers and governments users' data privacy is protected and that it poses no threat to national security.
Switching gears now, two Filipino-Americans organize a virtual chorus group in Texas featuring singers from some of the most renowned choirs in the Philippines. Cheryl Picho has the details.
Phil M. Vincent Evangelista, a University of Santo Tomas Singers alumnus, and Jenny Normand of the University of the Philippines Concert Chorus initiated a virtual chorus group in Houston, Texas.
What makes this simple project more special is the fact that it's composed of alumni singers from different university choirs from the Philippines.
From the Philippines, you will be very familiar that there's like a little competition amongst the universities and the choirs, who's better than who can sing better, who can win more competitions, all this and that. But this project was so special because we were able to sing together, having come from different choirs from the different universities. That was special.
The singers are from the 6 most awarded and most renowned choirs from the Philippines: Ateneo College Glee Club, De La Salle University Chorale, Philippine Madrigal Singers, UP Concert Chorus, UP Singing Ambassadors, and UST Singers. All are veterans and winners of the toughest and most prestigious chorale competitions in the world from their respective choirs.
One thing that I will say is, we are all one. You know, being in the U.S., there's still a lot of division, if you want. It's just like growing up in the Philippines, Luz V. Mindo, right? Like, which part of the country are you from? Like, what dialects, languages do you speak? And going to the U.S., it's the same thing. So there's that division. Unfortunately, it exists, right? And I am so happy that I have found people from the Philippines who also just want to be a part of one collective whole.
Out of the 23 singers, 5 are based in the U.S., 2 in Canada, 1 in Brussels, 1 in Paris, and 1 in Singapore, and the rest are based in the Philippines.
Well, after 3 years of being stuck at home and not being able to perform, this project was my perfect excuse to sing and reconnect virtually with fellow choristers from different universities and welcome the holidays.
Munting Sanggol is a beautiful song, and it's composed by Ryan Kayabyab, who is still currently my musical director for the Ryan Kayabyab Singers that I'm a member of.
Almost everyone in the choir never met each other, but they were united by the power and love of music in time for Christmas. The group plans more collaborative performances over the next year and promises to continue the spirit of togetherness in Christmas. Cheryl Pickshow, ABS-CBN News, Houston.
In sports, the Ateneo Blue Eagles' road to the UAAP Season 85 Championship was not easy. ABS-CBN Sports content lead Mix Bustos sat down with head coach Tab Baldwin to talk about the team's toughest title run yet. Here's an excerpt of that interview.
How do you describe your run? If you would get to summarize that in a couple of points, your run in Season 85.
I mean, obviously, if you're on the outside looking in, you see that, it was a bit patchy in the first round, our performances. We had some losses, big loss to LaSalle, and then lost to UP. And then we got into the second round. And, you know, obviously, after, you know, more games under our belt, we're starting to play better. But NU game was really tough. And, they proved their worth in this season and how strong they were. And they gave us a pretty good touch up in that game. It set us up for kind of having the right mentality coming into the UP game in the second round. And getting that win was a big boost for the team, big boost for our confidence. Just knowing that, you know, the defending champions, which are a very good team, but, you know, they'd had their ups and downs during the season as well. And then, you know, we didn't look great against FEU, but we kind of, you know, finished the season pretty strong with our game against Adamson. And then, of course, the semifinal against Adamson, and we had maybe our best game of the season. Coming into the finals, we knew it would be really tough. And I had a lot of players that were new to the finals, and they were anxious, nervous. And I think the first game, UP had a great start. Of course, you know, a great game two. And that really set up a game three, which was always going to be a battle royale, if you will. And I think that we had a great start in that game. And then we just held on. We already knew that Goldwyn and his coaching staff are good at making adjustments. They're good at changing things up. But a lot of that is, you know, just on the surface. Like, when you play a season as a basketball team, you develop a character. So for us, it was really about anticipating that there might be some cosmetic changes to what UP was doing, and there were. But those are really more, and we were doing the same thing. And those are really to sort of disguise as much as you can what your the true essence of your performance is going to be. But at the end of the day, we all come back to the norm after you've played a full season. You know, we just had to be ready to beat UP at their best. And of course, the loss of Xavier means they couldn't be at their very best. And they had to make some adjustments to that. And because that really thinned out their front line, we could, to a degree, anticipate sort of the combinations they were going to have to go with because they were fewer. And that helped us. You know, I'm not going to be one of those guys that say, oh, well, with or without Lucero, it would be the same game. I don't think so. You know, that was really bad fortune for them and good fortune for us. But that's sport, you know, and that's what Zave said to me after the game. He said, look, this is sport. This is what happens.
Catch the full interview on In the House on the ABS-CBN Sports YouTube channel.
In entertainment, fans of fantasy show The Witcher are getting a special treat this Christmas as Netflix debuts a four-part prequel called Blood Origin. Yong Chavez tells us more.
Michelle Yeoh first rose to fame in the 90s and made a name for herself in action films, where she did many of her own stunts. The former Bond girl and the star of critically acclaimed films like Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, has a new series called The Witcher Blood Origin, where she once again displays her remarkable fighting form.
Is it like second nature to you? Is it harder now, or how does it feel for you?
Well, I train every day. I have incorporated all these kind of things in my everyday routine. It's like, you know, when you wake up, you go through your whole routine. And this is part of how I live my life. So when I have a role like this, I don't have to go, oh, my God, I've not been practicing for the last half a year, so let me quickly get back into this. So but it's more important. It's like working with an amazing stunt coordinator who understands it's not just about the movement, but the drama. Mm-hmm. And where this character is coming from, that her tribe is called the Ghost Tribe. And why do they have a name like that? It's because they move around. You don't know where they are. They are not seen. You know, they're able to move with such speed and stealth.
In the four-part series, she plays a sword master, the very last from a nomadic tribe.
What aspect of the story really interested you?
It really was this character called Skien. And I've never played an elf before. I'm constantly looking for new challenges, new characters. So no one can put me in a box and say, oh, she can only do this kind of thing. It's like, if I want to play an elf, I want to play it in the series The Witcher, where everybody loves.
The actress also finds herself in a new position in Hollywood. She's one of the front runners for Best Actress this award season for her performance in Everything, Everywhere, All at Once.
Are you overwhelmed by it all, or like you're like taking it all in stride?
A bit of everything, actually. You know, you get overwhelmed, and you're like, what? No. Don't jinx me. Don't. And he's like, no, I'm not hearing this. And then it's like everybody, but I'm surrounded by amazing friends and family, especially also in the industry, who say, breathe. It's okay. Because yes, it's been a long, this is the first time.
The Witcher Blood Origin is coming out on Netflix starting Christmas Day. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
The Christmas weekend brings new movies in theaters and streaming. Maddie, the movie guy, tells us which ones are his favorites.
We are gathered here today to say goodbye to Puss in Boots.
Puss in Boots returns to the big screen only to say goodbye. This is his ninth and final life, and he's now looking for his purpose. The sequel is a bit darker for the little ones. It's talking about death after all, but if they can get past the darkness, they will be rewarded by the still amusing and colorful franchise that celebrates the beauty of life.
I am Puss in Boots.
And for that, Puss in Boots, The Last Wish gets 3 out of 4 meow kisses. Also in theaters, Babylon.
Babylon is about a group of people who find themselves in early Hollywood.
Damien Chazelle from La La Land returns to make another movie about Hollywood and gives us a film that is so entertaining and gripping, you won't be able to take your eyes off of the screen.
What do you say we come in for my close-up now?
Everyone's on their A-game in this film that simultaneously celebrates and rejects fame. Like most of Chazelle's films, this one's about the dreamers, and I'm strongly recommending this morality tale. And for that, Babylon gets the perfect 4 out of 4 debauchery kisses. And on Netflix, Glass Onion, A Knives Out Mystery.
Well, I want you to be on the roller coaster ride.
Writer-director Rian Johnson returns for this much-awaited sequel.
You can just let it wash over you and enjoy the ride.
Daniel Craig also returns as our favorite detective, Benoit Blanc.
Ladies and gentlemen,
this one is bigger, better, and funnier than the first one, complete with a heartfelt dramatic twist. So just enjoy the ride. And for that, Glass Onion, A Knives Out Mystery gets the perfect 4 out of 4 kisses. And finally, also on Netflix, Roald Dahl's Matilda the Musical.
This is the story of her great escape.
The big screen adaptation of the Broadway musical based on Roald Dahl's novel is magically, fantastically, and whimsically delightful.
I really like his reading.
Alicia Weir is great in the title role, and Emma Thompson is horrifying as the villain Miss Trunchbull.
Such a lovely sound.
Fun music that supports the uplifting tale about a girl who changes her story. Roald Dahl's Matilda the Musical gets 3.5 out of 4. Stream this now on Netflix. Kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ABS-CBN News.
And before we go, legendary Filipino band The Erasureheads brought meaning to Throwback Thursday as they rocked out in their first reunion concert in 13 years. That concert, named after their 90s hit song, Ang Huling El Bimbo, saw The Erasureheads singing over 24 songs. There were also special guests, including award-winning singer Gary Valenciano and the late Filipino rapper Francis Magalona through a hologram effect. Francis M's son, Parkin, as well as the son of lead vocalist Eli Buendia, also joined the band on stage. An estimated 75,000 fans attended what is believed to be the band's last concert in the Philippines, but they are expected to hold a world tour next year.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.
Mobility will be key to recovery.